the silent majesty of the mountains. This is the kingdom of the Alpine Ibex. He lives here among the other cliff dwellers inhabiting the higher regions of the Alps. The mountains are refuge to chamois, eagles, the ibex, and all other alpine wildlife inhabiting the high mountain landscapes of South Tyrol. Hubert is a professional gamekeeper and ranger. His regular inspections take him through this breathtaking beauty. As an experienced hunter, he is well aware of the seasonal dangers of the mountains. Paying close attention to the animals and the natural environment is his main task, and his observations continuously reveal new secrets. The Alps. Scientists assume that this European range of overlapping and folding mountains were formed ages ago as the African continental plate drifted northward to collide with the Eurasian continent. Today, the Alps stretch from their western extremities in France into Slovenia in the eastern part of Europe. Our journey takes us to the fascinating mountain landscape of South Tyrol in northern Italy. Thanks to intensive natural preservation measures taken by the South Tyrolean government, natural paradises of immeasurable value have been maintained in numerous national parks. Effortlessly, the golden eagle soars to the highest peaks. Golden eagles are general predators whose habitat extends over vast areas. In their forage for food, the chamois climbs high up into the mountains. Young kids become easy prey for the golden eagle. These agile creatures flee in controlled flight to bring their young to safety. To eat and to be eaten is all part of the natural cycle of an intact ecosystem. While Hubert concentrates on following the ibex, another ranger watches the chamois work to avoid the attack of the eagle. Records are kept even in nature. It's important to keep an eye on the health of the animals and to spot any disease that might befall the herd. Raising their young is quite a task for the golden eagle. After the eggs hatch, the parents are intensely involved in feeding their new offspring for about 2.5 months. Where the alpine marmot, a type of groundhog, abounds, it provides the staple of the golden eagle's diet. This king of the skies makes its nests below the level of its hunting grounds, in nooks and crannies in the rocky cliffs, and only seldom in trees. This makes it easier to transport prey to the nest. If two eagle eggs hatch, normally only the stronger of the young survives, the one who manages to force the rival sibling out of the nest. Life in the mountains is fraught with danger. Whether ending up on the menu of some meat-eating predator or falling victim to some fatal natural event, it all belongs to the complex cycle of nature. This cycle is the engine of survival and development on our planet Earth. There are no real victims in nature. Everything is an element of existence and part of a greater plan. The animals instinctively sense danger. As the permafrost zone shifts further up the mountains, chunks of rock work loose, causing unexpected rock slides. Such fresh breaks in the cliff face provide geologists with new insight and knowledge. Hubert, the ranger, keeps a lookout for animals that might have been injured or killed. Only the strongest animals survive. Even the golden eagle cannot take it for granted that it will manage to successfully raise its offspring each year. Soon, the young eagle will be on its own. Then hard years begin, until it finds the right mate and the appropriate place to continue this timeless cycle of procreation. The marmot is a very reproductive animal. Indeed, it is nature's plan that they produce many young for two main reasons. To keep each other warm in their underground burrows over the long winter months on the one hand, and on the other, they are indispensable as prey for various predators, such as the golden eagle, as we have seen. Great spotted woodpecker raises its young in hollows it has cut into trees with its strong beak. After the woodpeckers have moved on, these hollows become dwellings for other birds and animals which are not equipped to chop them out themselves, but need them to survive nonetheless. This forest carpenter works on his new home for about 2 to 3 weeks. The great spotted woodpecker feeds on insects. He chops his lunch right out of the bark of the tree with his chisel-like beak, and then settles into his custom-built dwelling to brood. The capercaillie, or wood grouse, is a typical forest dweller. It's a protected species in South Tyrol. Both hens and cocks live on the ground for the most part during the summer, but move up into the branches of the trees for the winter. The hen's speckled forest-colored feathers provide her with excellent camouflage. The courtship behavior of the proud male capercaillie, with his fluttering jump and the clearly visible girdle at his throat, is very typical. The courtship performance, the song, contains 4 verses: the clipped snapping, the trilling, the main beat, and the grinding or sanding. With its fanned tail, normally 18 shovel-shaped, partially white-speckled feathers, the cock cuts quite an elegant figure. The male capercaillies alternate between the courtship dance on the ground and courtship performances in the trees. Projects to reintroduce the largest alpine birds to their original habitat are in progress throughout the Alps. The goal of having the bearded vulture and the eagle owl, for example, naturally repopulate the entire alpine region without human help is getting close to being achieved. For time immemorial, the ibex has graced the lonely alpine landscape, Hubert, the ranger, knows that the ibex population was nearly wiped out with the invention of firearms. There are relatively few places to take cover in the upper mountain regions. That fact, and the animal's lack of fear of man, made overhunting quite easy, until the species was nearly killed off entirely. Under the protection of the Italian king Victor Emmanuel II, who was also a passionate hunter, a small ibex population was able to survive in the Grand Paradiso. Red deer live in herds. All of them are related in some way. An experienced doe leads the other female animals. Each year, at the height of summer, when the antlers of the male red deer have grown to their full glory and the hormone levels climb, every other buck becomes a competitor. Rutting season approaches. The older bucks become aggressive. The dominant male lets loose with intensive grunts, pipes, and screams. The mating season has begun for the red deer. He is challenged by a rogue bull. Most of the time, gestures and threats with bared teeth are sufficient to discourage the challenger. If that doesn't work, spectacular jousts with antler crashing loudly against antler determine which is the stronger animal. The dominant buck shows off his strong, stately form in the hope of intimidating his opponents. Only rarely does it actually come to an impressive fight, the sound of which can be heard from afar. It is normally the adult animals that end up mating successfully. Hubert is on the trail again. He has learned how to gauge his strength. He spends many hours on his own, and in a way carries on his own kind of conversation with the wild animals. The young kid is determined to find its mother. The older buck obviously goes his own way, totally untouched by the plight of the helpless youngster. He doesn't react at all to the kid's attempts to gain attention. The mother animal was probably rent to her death by an avalanche. Later on, the spring thaw will reveal her remains. The bizarre cliff landscape is home to the ibex. With astonishing grace, the rather plump-looking climber makes its way from rock to rock. Hubert doesn't miss a thing. With a passion which has become his profession, his eyes follow the kings of the mountain as they make their way, relaxed and secure in this harsh environment. They are unmoved by the snowstorms in winter, thunderstorms in the summer, the winds and the avalanches, and other moods and powers of nature. It is November. Time and again, the bucks shake themselves and perfume themselves with urine to attract attention. The chamois belongs to the family of horn bearers. They raise their hair, especially the chamois tuft on their back, to increase their apparent size. That is meant to intimidate potential rivals. Goats and kids live in herds guided by a lead goat. Just like the red deer, the chamois buck defends his herd. He repeatedly gathers his harem and, in wild chases, drives off other bucks that continually try to challenge the dominant buck's place in the herd. Not even deep snow can hinder the hard rivalry between the chamois bucks. Chamois are able to move very easily in the steepest of landscapes and among jutting overhangs of rock. The rutting season is particularly exhausting for the bucks. Their weakened state makes it even more difficult for them to make it through the harsh winter. Bad weather and the first snowdrifts are the harbingers of the approaching winter. The breaking storm ignores both man and beast. Hubert hastens toward the valley below to reach safer terrain. Wild animals have learned to survive in nature. They are able to adjust to the scarcity of food during the winter. Weak or sickly animals become prey or die of hunger. The surviving animals are able to put the food available to better use. The wild animal population is determined primarily by the nutrition provided by their environment. The following morning, a spectacular winter wonderland blankets the landscape. One last time, the buck courts the doe's favor in obvious desperation. The deep snow is no hindrance for him. The chamois tuft and those of the red deer and the badger are prized among hunters. A mature chamois tuft with hairs that are lighter colored at the tips is especially valuable. It is quite popular for the hunter to decorate his hat with the tuft and to wear it with pride. Contrary to the red deer annually shedding its antlers, the chamois never sheds its horns. The ibex manages the moods and dangers of nature quite well. They know how to choose steep, sunny places where the snow quickly melts or falls off in order to avoid those places where the deep snow lingers. As the chamois, the ibex has an incredible ability to jump and climb. Their natural habitat is found above the 3,000 meters above sea level mark. The first rule, while nature is in its winter hibernation state, is to preserve energy. That is the indispensable strategy for survival. In the deer family, Only the male animals carry antlers, which are shed and grown from scratch every year. The ibex and the chamois, on the other hand, keep their horns for their entire lives. On both male and female animals, the horns grow from the base at the skull during the vegetation season and keep growing year for year. During their first year of life, young male kids stay with their mother. After that, they join a herd of bucks. The young females stay with their herd. A little distant, seemingly always tired, and also somewhat proud, that's how a layman describes the ibex, this king of the mountain, which is thankfully becoming more and more common in the mountain landscape of South Tyrol. The ptarmigan, like the capercaillie, black grouse, and hazel grouse, belongs to the tetraonidus or grouse family. Every year, a number of small flaps of skin, which hunters called courtship flaps, grow on each of their toes. That expands their foot surface like snowshoes, very helpful for negotiating the deep snow. To survive the icy temperatures during snowstorms in the mountains, the ptarmigan lets itself be buried by the snow. That forms a protective, insulated cave, which protects the animal until the storm passes. The black grouse prefers to do his courtship dance in open spaces. The cocks work hard to impress the hens and intimidate competitors with their widespread feathers. Fights between competing cocks happen often in the courtship arena. Only the victor is allowed to approach the hen and court her favor with mincing steps and eventually mate. The courting song of the black grouse consists of hissing or blowing and rolling calls, which can often be heard from kilometers away. The black grouse, also called a playful grouse by the local peoples, likes company. He inhabits steppe-like or flat landscapes, or, as in South Tyrol, areas bordering the forests. The cock's tail feathers are far more impressive than those of the hen. They are a prized trophy among hunters. Courtship song reminds one of the cooing of an infatuated pigeon. One-on-one jousting dominates the scene on the courting grounds until night falls and everything is quiet for a time, until it all starts again with the next sunrise. Afterwards, the courtship ritual continues in the tree branches. In contrast to the red deer, the roe deer lives alone, or in small family groups which stay together during the winter. Their hearing is excellent, as is their sense of smell. If the deer becomes uneasy, it gives a sharp cry, which sounds similar to a dog's bark. It also makes a unique squeaking sound, which keeps the female deer in touch with her fawn. The rutting season takes place during high summer. Locals also call this the leaf season, because hunters in earlier days would use a birch leaf to imitate the call of a doe in heat. The roebuck casts his antlers in the late fall. A new set of antlers develops during the winter months. After the cold, harsh winter, the green pastures are a sight for sore eyes, and that not only for humans. This field rabbit takes refuge behind a bunch of green grass. A rare sight, which leaves even experienced wilderness experts amazed. As with people, albinos can even be found among deer. Since just a short time ago, it is again possible to run into gray herons along bodies of fresh water or in pastures and fields. These birds nest in colonies in mixed woodlands. Ranger Hubert again takes up the trail of the ibex, certain of being rewarded with many new experiences and greater insights into the lives of these fascinating creatures and their mountain habitat. Nothing happens in nature without a plan and a purpose. Only through the careful observation of the many often seemingly insignificant details of the environment, and through gaining insight into the secrets of the animal and plant world, does one become aware of how indispensable nature is, how precious, and how worthy of our respect and our protection.